While in life you come across somebody who seeks out the truth with a passion and a desire unlike what is common and normal to a human being. And one of these guys is here with us tonight. He's also a school teacher, but I love his passion for seeking out the truth and sharing it with others. And so would you all give a warm round of welcome to Peter Heck, who's here with us.
Thank you. Let me first thank Evelyn. And Evelyn, are those your kids? Spectacular. Absolutely amazing. Wonderful song. And a lot of you probably don't realize this, but Evelyn stepped in at the last second. I was actually slated to sing that song, but was unable to. It's really nice. It's really nice. For the laughter, you're getting a two-hour American history lesson tonight, so be ready for it. Truly, though, it is an honor to be here. I want you to imagine something, a hypothetical situation here. I want you to imagine that you go to the doctor's office with a runny nose. You can tell that the runny nose is going to turn into something, so you're trying to nip it in the bud. And so you go to the doctor's office, and the doctor comes in and examines you. He looks you over, he leaves the room, and he comes back, and he says, "I have what you need," and he hands you a box of Kleenex. He charges you $40 for the office visit, and you're on your way. A week later, you're back in the same doctor's office. You still have the runny nose, but now you've got a sore throat. So he examines you again, he leaves the room, and he comes back. He brings you another box of Kleenex, and this time a package of Hall's cough drops for your sore throat. He charges you another $40 for the office visit, and you're on your way. Third week comes along, you're back in the doctor's office, you've still got the runny nose, you've still got the sore throat, but this time you got a burning fever on top of it. He re-examines you, he comes back into the room, and he hands you a third box of Kleenex, a second package of Halls, and this time an ice pack for your fever. I would like to think that any of us in that situation, first of all, wouldn't need 3 weeks to figure it out, but I would like to think that none of us would continue to go to a doctor when it became obvious that that doctor was completely incapable of treating the actual problem, the disease that we have. They're merely treating the symptoms. I don't think a doctor who was inclined in such a way would last very long in the business. Friends, let me contend to you that that's exactly what we as American citizens have been putting up with for generations now. We've been listening to those who claim to have the answers and the solutions to our problems, and they are doing nothing but treating the symptoms of our problems. They're completely unfamiliar with the source of our disease. Let me suggest to you, believers, Americans, it's time for a new doctor. Time for a new doctor who will treat the source of our problems. You see, I listen to our political leaders, I listen to the great experts that we've hired to do all of these wonderful things, and what it reminds me of when I played Little League Baseball. Now, let's just be honest with each other, I'm going to address the obvious. When I played Little League Baseball, I was a stud. There's no question about it. I was the pitcher on the team, but this one particular day, I could not throw a strike to save my life. Couldn't even get the ball close to the plate. Now, the manager normally comes out and calms his pitcher down. My manager was only managing the team because the manager's got free concessions. He was not interested in actually coaching the team. So he's merely shouting out pieces of advice from the dugout. I heard things like, "Pete, just rock and fire. Pete, just rock and fire." I don't even know what it means to rock and fire, but that's what he was telling me. And then eventually he throws out this piece of wisdom. He said, "Don't aim the ball, Pete, just throw it." "Don't aim the ball. I'm aiming for a little plate," but he says, "Don't aim the ball, just throw it." So finally I'd had it. I'd walked in enough batters. I thought, well, I'll give it a shot. And I just reared back and I hurled that thing without paying any attention to where it was going. And I hit the batter. But not the batter who was up to bat. I hit the batter in the on-deck circle who was waiting to come up to bat. And the worst part of this is, and several of you who know my family know that my parents videotape everything that I did. My first day in college, I was getting out of the shower, and there was Dad with the camera. "Hey, son, way to go." Anyway, so this is all preserved on videotape, but that's what it reminds me of. When I listen to our political leaders, experts from both political parties, when they're giving us the solution, it reminds me of the blind boxer hurling punches in the dark, hoping that maybe they'll land one, and they aren't getting close. You see, we're told that we have monetary problems, money problems in America. Let me contend to you, Americans, we don't have money problems. We have moral problems in America. And in fact, if you think about it, we have debt. Everybody knows we have debt. But what is debt? What causes debt? Is it not a lack of stewardship? What is a lack of stewardship? It's a moral problem. We have people that are exploited in the marketplace. There's no question about that. But what causes that? What causes that exploitation? Well, greed does, and self-indulgence. What is that? It's a moral problem. We look at the failing school system, and I'm a school teacher. I hear it all the time about how American schools are failing. I don't dispute it. You can look around and see the consequences of it, but I'm amazed at the solutions that we hear. Well, maybe if we invested more money in our schools, really? We invest thousands more per student than we've ever invested before, and the product's getting worse. Well, maybe if we had better qualified teachers, our qualifications for teachers has never been as high as what it is today. Maybe if we had more technology. I work at a school that just handed an iPad to every kindergartner, and the freakiest thing is those kindergartners know how to use the iPad. It's the scariest thing you've ever seen. Friends, we're missing the mark completely. Let me just be blunt with you. You want to fix the problems in American education, fix the problems with the American family, and you will solve the problems in American education. You see, this is the reality for every financial, every economic, every cultural, every societal problem that you can come up with. I guarantee you I can tie it back to a breakdown in the moral backbone of our civilization. You see, that's exactly why John Adams, the second president of the United States, founding father, said this. Listen to these words. We have no government armed with power, capable of contending with human passions that are unbridled by religion and morality. I know, old English. Let me say it again. We have no government that is armed with power. We have no government strong enough that it can contend with human passions that are not restrained by religion and morality. Are you following what he's saying? Let me put it in plain English. You don't have a government big enough to stop crime. You can hire a police officer to follow every single individual around. You will never stop crime. Now, you can punish crime after the crime's been committed, but that's reactive. There is no government that is big enough to make people treat each other the way that they should. That's what Adams is saying. You see, Adams is telling us here in America, we're doing something radical. We're doing something that's never been done before. We are trying to free people and let them live free to a greater degree than has ever been done in the history of the world. But here's the danger, friends. If you make people free and they don't have any internal moral restraint, what's that going to look like? What's it going to look like when a bunch of free people don't have any internal restraint? Well, Adam said it himself. Avarice, ambition, revenge, gallantry would break the strongest cords of our Constitution as a whale goes through a net. In other words, with as great as the Constitution is, it is wholly inadequate, completely incapable of creating a happy people who are not restrained morally within themselves. It's why Adams went on and said this, our Constitution, listen, was made only for a moral and a religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other. Now, why is he saying that? Because Adams was some theocratic nut that was trying to force everybody into the baptistry through the force of law? Well, no, not at all. Of course not. He said that because John Adams realized that Christian principle teaches moral restraint, and that is the best friend of freedom. If you don't believe him, consider that in the days of our founding, they didn't have any gun laws. They didn't have any drug laws. They didn't have any child labor laws or minimum wage laws. Now, why didn't they have those laws? Because our founders were a bunch of gun-toting stoners that wanted to abuse kids in the marketplace? Is that what it was? No, friends, they didn't have those laws because they didn't need those laws. There was a common morality that existed across the hearts and the minds of the people that told them the way that they should use their freedom. And guess what? The government of the United States, get ready to be blown away, the government of the United States furthered that moral belief. It was the job of government to promote the morality that allowed freedom to endure. Now, what do we hear today? We hear today the exact opposite, that it's not the role of government to promote morality. Well, that would be news to the founding fathers. Why? Well, look what happened. As we got smarter than them, as we progressed in society, we started telling God he had no place in the public schoolroom. We started telling God he had no place in the public square at all. No place in government, no place in politics. We removed God out of the equation. And without the religious principle, national morality began to evaporate. And when national morality evaporated, when free people were no longer internally moral restrained, what did they do? They started taking advantage of each other. With their freedoms, they started abusing them and others. Now follow me. Those people who were abused and victimized, what did they then do? Being victimized, they cried out to who? They cried out to the government. Government, we need a law to protect us. These people that you've made free are misusing their guns. Write a law to forbid them to do that. So the government responded. Government, please, these people, they're not paying us what we're worth in the marketplace. Write a law so they have to. And so the government responded. As morality disappeared, people cried out to the government for more laws. And the government responded and responded and responded to the point where now, if you dropped our law code from the sky, it would demolish most small cities. But listen to me, every law that government writes, what do you lose a little of? Freedom. Do you see how this works? You see how this works? As morality disappears, government grows. And as government grows, freedom disappears. This is what our founders understood. When our founders spoke fondly of Christian principle, when Benjamin Franklin said of Christianity, it is the best the world ever saw or is likely to see. When James Madison called Christianity, quote, the religion we believe to be of divine origin. When John Adams called Christianity, above all religions that ever prevailed or existed on earth, the religion of freedom and equity, virtue and humanity. When his son, John Quincy Adams, said this, listen, this is amazing to me. You think of where we are today, it absolutely floors me. John Quincy Adams said, the highest glory of the American Revolution was this. It means the best part of the revolution was this. You ready for it? It connected in one indissoluble bond. That means it can't be severed. It connected in one indissoluble bond the principles of civil government with the principles of Christianity. Now think about where we are today, where we hear everyone telling us that we have to isolate the two. Civil government and Christianity can't have anything to do with one another. And here's John Quincy Adams saying the best part of the American Revolution was it connected those two things in an indissoluble, can't be broken bond. When we outsmarted the founding fathers, we created a lot of problems for ourselves. You see, these founders didn't say these things because they were rabid extremists trying to destroy people's freedom, not because they were theocrats. They said it because they were lovers of freedom. And they knew that freedom had no greater friend in the world than the principles and the precepts that were established by the author of human liberty, the Creator God Himself. If you don't believe me, I'm going to challenge you to do something. I challenge you to read George Washington's farewell address. Now, as a high school teacher, I can tell you don't look to your students' textbooks for that because it's not in there anymore. Washington's farewell address has been removed. It's been replaced with the UN Charter of Liberties. And I wouldn't waste my time reading that. George Washington's farewell address, though, I encourage you to find it. And when you do, do you know what you will read? These words. Of all the dispositions and habits which lead to political prosperity. I know, big words. Of all the dispositions that lead to political prosperity, everything that's going to make you a happy nation, religion and morality are indispensable supports. Isn't that amazing when you stop and think about that? Of all of the things that are going to be making you happy, it's not tax cuts, it's not free markets, it's not national security, it's not border security, none of that. The thing that's most important, the father of the nation said religion and morality. And he goes on and he sends a shot right through the heart of all of the smart people that run our country today when he says this, in vain would that man claim the tribute of patriotism. In other words, don't call yourself a patriot if you should labor to subvert these great pillars of human happiness, these firmest props of men and citizens. Think about what Washington just said. Washington is saying if you seek to remove religion and morality from the public square, don't call yourself a patriot because that is the backbone of this civilization. Think about where we are today. Think about who we elect, who we turn to, who we discuss, who we listen to. Removing or seeking to remove religion from the public square is the day job of half of the population today. And yet here's the father of the nation, George Washington, calling that very act unpatriotic. And I'll tell you right now, if you give me the choice of listening to the wise counsel of George Washington or the wise counsel of the entire staff at MSNBC, I've made my choice. I've made my choice. Washington said this, reason and experience both forbid us to expect that national morality will prevail in exclusion of religious principle. What does that mean? Remove religious principle from the public square and national morality will disappear. Now, the secular progressives will flip out at that. They'll lose all control of their bodily functions. You don't need Christianity to be moral. You don't need Christianity to have a good and healthy, just be good for goodness sake. Really? Turn on your 11 o'clock news. First story of the night. Freedom from Religion Foundation has won another lawsuit. So a bulldozer's pulling up to a courthouse lawn, sticking its forks into the lawn, lifting up two stone tablets, placing those tablets on the back of a flatbed truck, and it disappears off into the distance. Second story of the night, double homicide on the city's northeast side. Third story of the night, a serial rapist is struck again. Fourth story of the night, an Amber Alert has been issued. Another child's been abducted. And as I sit there and I watch the procession of the bad news, story after story after story, I cannot help but become convinced, I cannot help but become convicted of the reality that the second and the third and the fourth stories are directly related to the first story of the night. The reality, friends, that the removal of God from the public square, it is not freeing us. It's not liberating us, it's shackling us. It's not delivering us, it is destroying us. It is not freeing our children. The removal of God from our culture is forging their chains. What do I mean? Well, let me give you an analogy to think of it this way. Some of you, most of you, hopefully all of you, remember the playground in elementary school. Now, for some of you, it may have been the plastic OSHA-approved jungle gym that we have today. Others of you, it might have been the era before where you had the metal slide that burned your skin off in the summer if you sat down on it. Still others of you, maybe a little bit more seasoned, you had a mound of dirt with some sticks. I don't know what it was for you, but everybody had the playground in elementary school, and we all had rules we had to follow on the playground in elementary school. What were some of those rules? Well, you couldn't kick the ball over the building into the creek, and you couldn't hog the equipment, and you couldn't pull the girl's hair, and you couldn't spit in the girl's hair, and you couldn't shave the girl's hair. These are all rules that you had on the playground. Now, why did you follow the rules on the playground? Well, I don't know who it was for you, but for me, as a third grader at Rio Grande Elementary School in Terre Haute, Indiana, it was all 6'7", 385 pounds of Mrs. Deckard standing in the corner of the playground. That is why I followed the rules, because I knew that if I broke those rules, Mrs. Deckard was going to come over and grab me by the bottom of the ear and drag me in to see the vice principal. Nobody had ever seen this man and lived to talk about it. It was just rumor. And it was that fear and that reverence and that respect that we had for the authority figure on the playground that kept us following those rules. Now, go back to the playground and remember the days when Mrs. Deckard got a phone call in the main office, or Mrs. Deckard had to go potty, and Mrs. Deckard left the playground. What happens when there's no monitor on the playground? For a while, nobody realizes it, and everything continues as it always had because it's tradition. But then pretty soon, someone new to the playground or somebody that starts noticing, hey, there's no authority figure here. What do? Well, they don't give up the jump rope. And we go over to them and say, well, you got to give up the jump rope. And they say, why? Well, we say, well, rule number two clearly states that you cannot hog the equipment, which you are now doing. And they say, listen, those may be your rules, but they're not my rules. I'm not going to give up the jump rope. And somebody else takes a big chunk out of the girl's hair. And we go running over to them and say, you clearly cannot pull the girl's hair. And they say, why not? And we say, rule number eight says no pulling the girl's hair. And they say, listen, you radical right-wing Christian fundamentalist extremist nut job. Those may be your 10 commandments. Those may be your rules, but they're not mine. I make up my own truth. I make up my own rules. And friends, what do you have? You have a playground in chaos. And on a playground in chaos, in complete anarchy, whose will always presides? Who always rises to the top of a playground in chaos? The biggest, the strongest, the bully. Me, if I'm on the playground, everybody understands that. I'm just intimidating. That is what happens on a playground in chaos. We understand this on the playground. Why don't we understand it when it comes to civilizations? Think back throughout the history of the United States. For the longest time, we understood that there was a moral authority that presided over the destinies of nations. We knew that there was a fixed point of reference by which we could determine right from wrong, good from bad, true from false, yes from no. Not just in our individual lives, but in our life as a culture and our life as a nation. Because our founding fathers wrote those immortal words, we hold these truths to be self-evident. Nobody has to explain them. They are self-evident. To which the laws of nature and nature's God entitle us. Our founders were saying there is a transcendent authority that rules over us whether we like it or not. And it was the respect and the reverence we had for that authority, Mrs. Deckard, on our playground, on our cultural playground, that kept us following the rules. But what happened? Starting in the 1960s, in court case after court case, we started removing Mrs. Deckard from the playground. God, you don't belong in the public schoolroom. God, you don't belong in the public square. You don't belong in government. You don't belong in the arts. You don't belong in entertainment. You belong in the church, and we'll come and see you on Sunday mornings, but please stay there and let us run our lives for ourselves. And what happened? Well, for a while, everything continued like it always had because it was tradition. But then someone new to our playground came along, somebody that noticed there was no longer any authority and said, you know what, I don't want this child inside me. And we said to them, what in the world are you talking about? You can't destroy that life. And they said, why not? And we said, because it bears the image of Creator God, and therefore it is inviolable. And they said, well, those may be your rules, but they're not mine. I make up my own rules. And somebody else came along and said, well, I love this person who happens to be of the same sex. And the God that I serve would never have a problem with me being with them. And we said that offends the very natural law that God has put into place. And when we see the physical and the spiritual consequences of that lifestyle, no loving individual, listen to me, Christians, no loving individual would ever encourage another person that they care about to embrace such a deadly and condemned lifestyle. No one in an act of love would do so. Even with the best of intentions, would never do so. And we said that, and they said, what? Well, listen, you radical right-wing Christian fundamentalist extremist nut job, those may be your rules, but they're not mine. I make up my own rules. And what do we have, friends? We have a culture in chaos where everyone is running around claiming to make their own rules. If it happens on the playground, it will happen in society. The bully is not long in coming. Now, sometimes the bully comes in different ways. Sometimes he comes through brute strength and subjugation, but sometimes the bully comes promising to protect you, promising to make sure that you don't fail by offering more and more of his programs to you. But the result is the same. Your freedom lost, his strength crystallized. And I will tell you, that is not a path that leads to happiness. It's a path that throughout history has led to misery. Our founders knew it, we've lost sight of it, and we must reclaim it. There are a lot of great ideas that are out there. People say, well, we need to fix the tax code. We need to open up trade. We need to abolish the IRS. We need to return state sovereignty. We need to protect the border. We need to empower the individual. Listen, those are all fine ideas, all necessary, all worthwhile goals. But listen to me. Until the United States of America reclaims her moral center, until she embraces again the Judeo-Christian ethic of her founders and her founding, we will continue to merely sweep out the cobwebs. And listen to me, I've had enough of that. I'm ready to take out the spider. And the spider in our society is sin. And there is one cure for sin. It is time that we, the church, rise up in this land while we still have the numbers and we still have the voice to say there is one solution to sin. And it comes in the name that is above all other names. And at the name of Jesus Christ, let every knee bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord and he is Lord of all. And we do so without hesitation. We do so without reservation. We do so without equivocation. Why? Because Jesus didn't say, I know a way. He said, I am the way. He didn't say, I can tell you some truth. He said, I am the truth. He didn't say, I can show you how to live. He said, I am the life. And he didn't say, as Oprah did, that I'm one of the many paths, one of the many roads that you can get to whatever it is that you call the light. He said, no man comes to the Father except by me. Christians, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man gets to heaven except by me. If you want to make a difference in your society, embrace that truth and have the courage to speak it. I'm ready, and I hope you're ready to stand with me. Then and only then can we honestly repeat those words. The fourth verse that Francis Scott Key wrote, overlooking Fort McHenry, the words that so many people don't even know exist. Oh, thus be it ever, when free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation. Blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven-rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved us a nation. Then conquer we must, when our cause it is just. And this be our motto, in God is our trust. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave over the land of the free and the home of the brave. May God pour out his blessings on this land, because the people of this land once again have blessed God. Thank you for your time and your attention.